Hi there, Doug Stone with IT Creations with a GPU server from Gigabyte, the 2U G292-Z44 GPU server. I've done a few reviews of other Gigabyte GPU servers, so this might look somewhat similar to a few other videos I've done in the past. You can check out one of them right here. For a 2U platform supporting dual AMD EPYC processors and up to 8 Gen 4 GPUs, it's quite special. Thumbs up, subscribe, whatever, let's go! The form factor is the same. I think I initially described it as looking like a dropship carrier from Halo or something to that effect. You know, thrusters on each side with a deployment ramp right down the middle. I think that's still a valid description. The system is NVIDIA certified as a data center server, but also as a high density VDI server, you know, virtual desktop infrastructure. Applications include AI, AI training, AI inference, visual computing, and the all important high performance computing. Looking at the front of the system, you can see large fans to either side of the central storage cage. Those bays can be outfitted with Gen 3 NVMe, SATA, or SAS hot swap drives. SATA or SAS in the left 4 trays with blue drive tray release tabs, and up to 4 Gen 3 U.2 or SATA drives in the drive trays with orange release tabs. A small control panel on the left has a power on button, unit ID button, then LEDs for LAN 1 and LAN 2, hard drive status, general system status, and a reset button. Need a GPU server? Perhaps you're interested in this Gigabyte G292-Z44 GPU server. If you are, then for a limited time, you can save up to $500 off a system that's listed or one that you can configure at IT Creations that's valued at $5,000 or more. Click that link to try out our configurator and configure a system to your specifications. It's fun for the whole family. Well, maybe that's an exaggeration. Around back, again, 2 large fans to either side with an I/O panel and PSUs in the middle. PSUs support on the system are either 80 plus platinum or titanium 2200 watt units with 2 plus 0 redundancy, which means no redundancy. Not really that surprising given the configuration with up to 8 double wide GPUs, not to mention the power needs of the dual AMD EPYC CPUs. From left to right, a VGA port, a dedicated management 1 gigabit Ethernet LAN port, power button with LED, ID button, then reset button on top, with non-maskable interrupt button below. Then a system status LED, 2 10 gigabit Ethernet RJ45 ports with activity LEDs to either side, and lastly, 2 USB 3.0 ports. Above all of that, 2 PCI slots. There are also vents about halfway down the side of the chassis on both sides for pulling in fresh air, but we'll get to that. Once I remove the cover panel, or at least Photoshop does, then you can see a very compact layout with several fans to keep the system cool and a plastic cowl over the CPU and memory module slots. There are 3 clear thermal zones. For the 8 GPUs, there are 2 GPU cages stacked on each side for 4 GPU riser cages total, each capable of housing 2 GPUs. The front 2 fans blow cool air into the chassis for the first set of GPU risers. That GPU-centered air is then directed mostly under the slightly raised motherboard, allowing fresh air from the center front fans to push air over the top of the motherboard with the GPUs and memory modules, but also over the PSUs mounted under the motherboard. For the GPU risers towards the rear of the chassis, there is a large fan mounted just behind the side vent to pull fresh air in from the perforated panels on either side of the chassis. 2 fans mounted on the back of the system then pull that air through the GPUs to be exhausted out of the back of the system. The integrated fans in the PSUs also help pull the heated air out of the chassis. An elegant and simple design. Well done, well done. The system has dual processors, either 7002 or 7003 series AMD EPYCs. Each processor features 8 channel memory architecture and is in charge of 8 memory module slots for 16 memory modules divided between the 2 processors. With both 7002 and 7003 series CPUs, you get up to 64 cores and 128 virtual threads per CPU. And that's with a system thermal design power threshold of 240 watts per CPU. Both support DDR4 memory speeds at up to 3200 megatransfers per second and a PCI 4.0 interface. It's not until we get to the next generation that we get support for DDR5 and PCI 5.0. In addition to those 8x16 PCI 4.0 slots for the GPUs, there are 2 more low-profile PCI 4.0x16 slots in back. Those can be used for HD controllers, which you will need for SAS drive formats, high-speed NICs, or maybe a little both. As this system is a dual root configuration with both CPUs taking half the load for memory, storage, and PCI slots, each CPU is in charge of one of those low-profile PCI slots in back. There are several NICs supported on this system, offering speeds from 1 gigabit per second per port up to 200 gigabit per second per port. A fast Ethernet connection would go a long way towards providing less latency and greater bandwidth for VDI environments, and potentially less user frustration from a slower connection. Might as well look at the GPUs at this point, and there are quite a few supported on this system. With 8 PCIe 4.0x16 slots, this platform can handle up to 8 300-watt GPUs. That right there tells you why there is a 2 plus 0 redundancy. Just the power drain from the 8 GPUs at 300 watts each adds up to 2400 watts of unadulterated power. Why did I say unadulterated? I don't know, it kind of sounded good. Anyways, CPUs at up to 240 watts each for 480 watts added onto 2400 watts for 2880 watts. And then you can add in the little bits like memory modules at 3 to 5 watts each and those U.3 NVMe drives in the four bays up front at about 25 watts each, combined for another 100 watts. Less for the other drives, so I'll ignore those. But then you also have the 6 fans and whatever other PCIe controllers that might be installed. The power gets very quickly whittled away. Thankfully, Gigabyte has something called Smart Crisis Management and Protection. If one of those PSUs goes south, SCMP will throttle back the system and reduce the power load to prevent unexpected shutdowns, component damage, or data loss. For managing the system, Gigabyte offers the embedded and, free of charge, Gigabyte Management Console. No acronym for that one. It allows for real-time monitoring and management with support for standard IPMI specifications, plus event recording and control of Broadcom MegaRAID storage controllers. Next on the menu is the Gigabyte Server Management, or GSM. This one is available for download and helps administrators manage clusters of servers simultaneously. GSM complies with Redfish and IPMI standards. In addition to providing more management tools than the management console, there is also a GSM mobile app and a plugin for VMware vCenter. Got a little distracted. Back to the GPUs, and as I said, quite a few support on the system from both NVIDIA and AMD. GPUs can have a TDP from 40 to 60 watts with the NVIDIA A2, up to 300 watts with, say, the NVIDIA A180 Gigabyte, or even those two AMD Radeon Instinct cards, the MI100 and the MI210. Some of them are better at compute, while those RTX cards are better at graphics rendering. For all of them, except one, you can install 8 GPUs. That exception would be the NVIDIA A16, and you can only install 4 of those. Why? I don't know, but we'll get to the bottom of that. The NVIDIA A16 seems to be very divisive. When you look online, it is quite expensive, but enterprise-class GPUs usually are. This card is not good for gaming, but what this card is good for is virtual desktop infrastructure, or VDI, and video encode and decode. It can support up to 64 concurrent users with graphics-rich VDI. That would be 1 GB of the 64 GB of GDDR6 memory available from the GPU for each user. It does that using NVIDIA Virtual PC or NVIDIA Virtual Workstation software. Packed in a sleek gold case, the NVIDIA A16 GPU card is not really the actual GPU. The GPU, or graphics processing unit, is a chip on the circuit board contained in that PCI card that plugs into your PCI slot. Typically, there is only one GPU on a GPU PCB. The NVIDIA A16 has 4 separate GPUs on the circuit board. Each of those 4 GPUs can access 16 gigabytes of GDDR6 memory connected via a Mellanox PCI switch. NVIDIA's virtual software, either Virtual Workstation or Virtual PC, divides the workload between up to 64 virtual users with 16 times 4 users. 64 users because, through testing, NVIDIA has determined each user can still benefit from just a single gigabyte of GDDR6 memory. Beyond that number, the user experience is impacted. So instead of all the traffic from virtual users queuing up for a single 64 gigabyte GPU on the circuit board, now there are 4 separate queues for each of the 4 integrated 16 gigabyte GPUs. This translates to fewer virtual users trying to access a single GPU, which can cause processing delays. Different profiles can also be used for each of the 4 integrated GPUs to address power users that would require greater memory assets. In essence, one of those graphics processing units on the A16 can be divided between up to 16 users, each grabbing 1 GB of the 16 gigabytes available. Meanwhile, another of the GPUs can take that 16 gigabytes and divide it between 2 users, each with 8 gigabytes of memory. Each GPU can also be assigned a different license, perhaps virtual workstations on one GPU and virtual PC on the others for standard office workers. The card features 4 encoders and 8 decoders, also divided between the 4 GPUs. This enables the encoding and decoding to be offloaded to the GPU rather than the CPU. While the A16 is not designed for raw power, it excels at distributed workloads, not gaming. Although that said, you can game lightly. Still, it does have 160 tensor cores and 40 ray tracing cores that can also be used for AI plus machine learning and inference. Only 4 cards on the G292-Z44 server because with more cards, there are diminishing returns on performance, depending on how the resources of each card are allocated. Theoretically, you could have 4 times 64 or 256 virtual users. From what I've read, the sweet spot seems to be 2 cards at 128 virtual users, each at 1 gigabyte per memory per CPU. And we have 2. Little segue there at the end, but I do hope you enjoyed this review of the Gigabyte G292-Z44 GPU server. At only 2U, but with dual processors and up to 8 GPUs, I think it's more than fair to say it's packed with performance. If you want to learn more about this system, I placed a few links down below, or you can use that one right there, itcreations.com. Until next time, I'm Doug Stuman. Thanks for watching.